Okay, we just going to make this up for a customer down in London. It's one of the grade 2 offers. So you can see how a silver sovereign is made up. It's been pressed to feel, and it feels nice. So now it's down to me to get the right pick up, the right feel with a lovely shape to it. Before we start up, it's actually weighing in at, weighs in at 3.7 at the minute in that state. And the spec is 29210. Okay.
Well, I've been loving you till you were 17. Baby, my
thank you. Halloween and the one day of the year that my wife Gloria's cooking looks, smells and tastes slightly less summer-churning than the other 364. Having said all that, it's still very frightening. From John in Belfast. Michael, could you please say a few more scary words using that echo effect machine? If I take it, I might save a few quid on special effects tracks. That's what Ian, sorry. Hold on 1 second, Ian. I want to Forest, only teardrops. Choices, and the last two, they don't fail either. How about this one? Goodbye Yellow Brick Road and Elton John. We're talking to Pat after this.
Friends to go, sports to
you have it at that moment, and then you must have a little tinkle on it later.
Well, if I sit down at a piano like that, I just embarrass myself and the piano.
How do you go about writing?
I can play several instruments like a singer, and none of them like a proper musician. Guitar, or just let other people kind of sort out the music part, and I'll take care of the melody and the lyric.
Got the new album, Bulletproof, Picasso. It's a great title.
Oh, thanks.
Well, I've been playing Angel of Duties to death.
Yeah, thank you.
It's a great track. What can we look forward to on the album? What is it saying?
You know, I think if I was going to try to describe this, I would say that I think we finally were able to connect Train's past and Train's future. And this is what it would sound like, this album, where it's going to have a little Quentin Tarantino music like Angel in Blue Jeans, and it's going to have a little Meet Virginia to it, but also Hey Soul Sister and Drive By and those different elements that we've run into. And I think that maybe this is my best lyric work, this album. There's not a lot of cutesy pop culture references. It's more like from the heart. And I think that that's what I'm hoping people will get from it.
Well, I'm a huge fan, as I told you earlier. Can we look forward to seeing you playing live here?
Yeah, we plan to come here as often as we're invited. You know, we wanted to finish this record, and hopefully it'll do well enough here that we can come here quite a lot.
Well, consider the invitation open to come here to Radio 2.
It's okay to stay at your house then.
Yeah, no problem at all. I charge very little.
That's a good one for me to keep my eye on for future hooks. You know, man, I'll take that one for a little bit. And Tom Petty can write hooks, and man, his guitar player, Campbell, I can't remember his first name, but man, nobody can write a guitar hook better than that.
Thank you. trumpeting. Running down a dream, the final choice. A pat on the head. And now this very, very important message. Please listen.
It's out now with more for you to discover. Yes, it is I, the Dark Lord, Alex Lester, taking over writing duties for the latest Radio 2 Mail. This week,
Joe Wiley puts your questions to Status Quo.
You join us for a Status Quo Q&A here at the Roundhouse with two men who are completely at ease, really relaxed, on a single nerve about them all.
Miranda Hart makes a big announcement on the big show.
I know this is a joke. Is this an announcement? I've been talking out loud. What? It's a bit weird.
No.
And Candy Stato performs for Terry Wogan.
I know for a fact it is, because I saw her at the weekend.
So showbiz.
I know, I am showbiz.
That's drop that name. That name drops.
You're so traffic and traffic.
I am, yes. Pedestrian, stuck. Derbyshire, one lane blocked on the M1 northbound at junction 30 for work. So thanks to Jessica's dad for the updates in lane one. M6 southbound, Staffordshire, one lane blocked on the M6. Southbound, just before Gailey at junction 12, says the boy. Just by the exit slip, about half a mile before the exit queues back to junction 13. Snakey says the M1 northbound with gap. There's been an accident in amongst the roadworks. Queues already back to the Daventry turn at junction 16. In Essex, Al, the chauffeur says the M11, a couple of miles after junction 8, the standstill. Northbound says it's more or less of a standstill. Not sure why. We don't know why either. Laura and all the family on the A12 says southbound junction with the A414. So I'm assuming she's around Great Faddo. There's a lorry that's missing its wheel, partially sticking out into lane one. Berkshire, M4, one lane closed eastbound between Windsor at 6 and Langley at 5 by a broken down lorry. M25 struggling anti-clockwise at 17 round to 15 for the M4 after an earlier broken down vehicle. Mike also says it's going anti-clockwise up to the Dartford Tunnel from junction 2. And in Wiltshire, Andy Pandy says it's very slow for the A303, easily so, between the Amesbury roundabouts and Stonehenge. He's been stuck there about half an hour. It looks like it's just the end of half-term traffic. Thanks for all your calls. Bobby was back with notes. A very busy afternoon.
How was the A3?
I've told him to clear it for you.
Can you say it's really, really chock-a-block at all costs?
Yeah, totally.
I've loved this week with you, darling.
It's been a pleasure.
A joy. Thank you. Have a lovely weekend.
When you take that jump, don't be afraid. Hope when the world arises, you will fall. Hope when the crowd screams out, screaming your name. Hope if everybody runs, you choose to stay.
lived. And I have lived all this time. Thoroughly enjoyed myself. Thank you for your company. Hope we get to do it again sometime. Ken's back next week. I've got one more big Halloween live for you. Are you ready?
She should go. Watch out, an increasing number of adults are going back to using skateboards. Do you buy tickets from self-service machines at stations? If you do, are you being denied the cheapest fare? And how is Terry Walton coping with a prolonged Indian summer and the Jeremy Vine Show allotment? You can give me a ring on 0500-288-291. Calls are free for most landlines. Some networks and mobile operators may charge for these calls. You can email vine at bbc.co.uk or contact us via text, Twitter and Facebook. Here's the news with Alan
Dedicat. Thanks, Vanessa. Police investigating a blaze at a fireworks warehouse in Stafford now say that two people are unaccounted for. A man has been arrested. Dramatic bursts of fireworks and thick smoke could be seen for miles at the height of the blaze yesterday evening. Correspondent Frankie McCamley is at the scene.
One man, a 53-year-old, has been arrested. We also have two people unaccounted for, as well as that, four people injured last night, two of whom have been confirmed to be remaining in the hospital. And firefighters still here on the scene trying to put this fire out so police officers can begin their investigation.
Downing Street has reiterated the Prime Minister's support for the woman chosen to lead the government's inquiry into historical child sexual abuse. Organisations representing victims of child abuse are meeting officials from the inquiry amid mounting pressure on Fiona Wolfe to resign because of claims of inappropriate links to establishment figures. David Cameron's official spokesperson said he thought she could do the job with integrity and impartiality. The Chief Constable of Avon and Somerset, Nick Gargan, is to face a hearing on charges of gross misconduct. He'd been investigated by the Independent Police Complaints Commission for alleged inappropriate behaviour towards women and improper disclosure of information. He denies any wrongdoing. Health experts are calling for alcoholic drinks to have calorie labels to help reduce obesity. The survey has found that most people underestimate the calorie content of wine and beer. Tam Fry from the National Obesity Forum says that having calorie counts on alcohol is long overdue.
A lot of people don't really understand that with alcohol, you're also consuming a huge amount of totally useless calories, which will just sit on you. And furthermore, the whole thing will disrupt your normal digestion as well, because it just blocks the system.
And police in the Chinese capital Beijing have warned people that they face arrest for wearing Halloween costumes on the city's underground system. State media says the authorities are worried that people with fancy dress and scary makeup could cause panic and even a stampede. That's the BBC News at 3:12, and next at 1.
Thanks, Alan. Coming up, is Lord Mayor of London having a funeral? The right person to lead the historic sex abuse inquiry.
I never thought I'd miss you half as much as I do. And I never thought I'd feel this way, the way I feel about you. Soon as I wake up, every night, every day, I know that it's you I need to take the blues away. It must be love, love, love. It must be love, love, love. Nothing more, nothing less, love is the best. How can it be that we can say so much without words?
And it must be love. When the Home Secretary Theresa May announced an overarching child sex abuse inquiry in July, she no doubt expected controversy. It was, after all, going to look at whether public bodies, including the government itself, had done enough to protect children from sexual abuse since 1970. But today, controversy surrounds not the content of the inquiry, but the person leading it. Fiona Wolfe, a lawyer and Lord Mayor of London, is facing calls to step down before the inquiry has properly begun. She stands accused by campaigners of being too close to the former Home Secretary, Leon Britton, whose own handling of abuse claims in the 1980s is under scrutiny. He denies any wrongdoing. Wolfe had previously written to Theresa May stating that she lived in the same street as him and has had dinner with him 5 times, but, and I quote, that he was not a close associate. But now, earlier drafts of that letter have been published, which suggest she had more contact with Lord and Lady Britton than originally thought. Fiona Wolfe is the second person to lead this inquiry, which has still yet to begin. Her predecessor, Dame Elizabeth Butler-Sloss, was forced to stand down because of her own family's links to Leon Britton. In the last half hour, as you heard on the news, Prime Minister David Cameron said Fiona Wolfe can do this job with integrity and impartiality. So do you think she's the right person to lead this inquiry? Give us a call on 0500 288 291, and email Vine at bbc.co.uk. Let's kick off with Chris Mason, the BBC's political correspondent. Chris, good afternoon.
Hi, Claire.
Professor?
Well, this story runs and runs, doesn't it, really?
It does, and it all boils down to a really central question. Is it possible to have the clout and the credibility and the respect and the CV, if you like, to lead an inquiry into something so controversial, something that is so public and followed, if you like, without being a part of the establishment to such an extent that people start asking whether you're independent and whether you're impartial? Now, you would think the answer to that would be straightforward, that the answer would be yes, you would be able to find somebody who ticked both boxes. And yet, for the second time, as you were just saying, the government is facing questions, and an occupier of the chair of this inquiry is facing questions about whether or not their connections, who they know, who they've had tea with, which award specials they've been to and who they were sat next to, might mean that they are partial. They cannot be impartial, they cannot extricate themselves from their social connections to look at this in a way that is sufficiently sort of few steps back to be independent, if you like.
Tell us about the letter. Why is there a letter? Who is it from? Who is it to? And why are we now looking at several draftings and redraftings of said letter?
Yeah, it turns out there is more than one letter. There's one final letter, but seven different drafts where Fiona Wolf was trying to set out effectively why she believes that she is independent and she is impartial. She was trying to be open, this is what the government says, about the connections that she had, particularly with the Britton family, Lord and Lady Britton, Lord Britton, Home Secretary back in the 1980s, as you acknowledge. As you mentioned, she acknowledged that they lived in the same street, that they'd had dinner parties at each other's houses. What's frustrated a guy called Keith Vaz, who's the chair of the Home Affairs Select Committee, who was sent these letters, is that when you look at the drafts, what is clear in his eyes is that the later drafts suggest a greater distance between
and I quote, there were no other guests who attended the dinner with the Christian family in November 2012. And the final thing, they said, there were, and I quote, at least three other guests, which makes the meal then sound less intimate, less friendly, more formal, and much more business. And I wrote, I went to dinner there, but really, more guests than ever there, but less people there, so it was a more formal context. And I feel that you can be on the meal, which is the thing. And here we just hear in the metric of the
we don't know definitively, because we haven't heard from Fiona Wolf, and she doesn't want to do interviews at this stage beyond saying that she continues to believe she can do this inquiry fairly and impartially, is whether or not that was simply a process of her having to think incredibly carefully about who on earth was around the kitchen table in 2000 whenever, eating tea on whatever night of the week it was when this dinner party took place, and as a result of doing research and spending some time looking in her diary, she realised there were rather more people there than she thought originally. Or, as he says, there's been a process of suggesting via these drafts that she is more capable than the earlier drafts might have implied. And that's why this is becoming quite awkward for her. I think the point, Vanessa, for Fiona Wolf and whether she continues in this role is going to come in the next couple of hours when the victims of abuse and the groups representing them come out of a meeting taking place here at Westminster with people involved on that panel of inquiry. The language they strike when they come out is going to be absolutely crucial. But plenty have gone in being sceptical. If they were to come out, I say if because they might not, if they were to come out and say there's no way we can be associated with this if she continues, we would be heading into the territory, I suspect, where her position might be untenable. The flip side of that is if she survives today and all of the criticism she's facing, particularly given there's a huge demand to see this thing actually get going as opposed to rows about who the chair is, then maybe she'll continue in the role.
It is interesting, though, isn't it, that in the last half hour, the Prime Minister has spoken on this subject instead of Fiona Wolf. She can do this job with integrity and impartiality. You might have thought it would have been a bit cagey about getting involved quite so soon. I might have waited to hear, as you say, the victim speak first. But no, he spoke first. It sounds like he's leading the agenda on this very much.
Funnily enough, you know, when reporters like me ask the Prime Minister's spokesman whether or not he has, you know, full confidence in whoever it might be, that is usually a good sign that confidence is slipping away from said person. Now, he has said, via his spokesman this morning, yes, you know, she remains the person we want to lead this inquiry in, and let's get on with it. He couldn't really say anything other than that, in that he had been seen to caveat his language. That would have been interpreted as the carpet, the rug being pulled from underneath her. So what's clear now, given what the Home Office is saying, given what Downing Street is saying, and what some of the victims are saying, is that it's down to her. It's ultimately down to her. She was in post until she resigned. She's currently still in post. It'll be up to her whether or not she wants to try and weather all of this flak and then got on with the job of chairing the inquiry. There are others, by the way, who criticise her because they wonder if she's got sufficient expertise, never mind her connections, they wonder if she's got sufficient expertise. Or she might conclude, you know what, life's too short, and I can't stand the flak, and maybe there is somebody who wouldn't get quite so much stick for doing this.
Chris, thank you very much indeed. Let's go to Simon Danchuk, Labour MP for Rochdale, author of a recent book exposing alleged sex abuse of children by the late Lib Dem MP Cyril Smith. Hello, Simon.
Hello.
Well, what do you make of these redrafted and rewritten letters?
I think it's appalling. I think what's happened here is that the Home Office have been colluding with Fiona Wolf in an attempt to cover up her closeness to Leon Britton. Fiona Wolf had said at the Select Committee a couple of weeks ago that she wanted full transparency. Well, this shows that there hasn't been transparency. They've been doctoring letters so that she looks like she isn't that close to Leon Britton.
But is it, hang on a second, is it fair to call redrafting doctoring? Doctoring implies, you know, that you're forensically removing key facts. Could it be that she simply didn't remember whether she'd been for dinner twice or three times?
Well, if we compare the letters from the first draft through to the seventh, the tone of the letters, the language in the letters, some of the facts change, and it gives the impression, as Keith Badd, the chairman of the Home Affairs Select, the impression that there is distance between Fiona Wolf and Leon Britton. Now, in the first letter, that wasn't the case. It clearly showed that there was connections between the two of them. You know, the truth of this is that she is far too close to Leon Britton to be able to chair this inquiry. And just by the very fact, she should rule herself out. Why hasn't she ruled herself out earlier on? She thought, listen, I'm too close to the former Home Secretary. I've been to dinner with him on a regular basis. We are effectively family friends. And I am not suitable to do this job.
She specifically has not said any of those things. She hasn't said she's close to him. She hasn't identified herself as a family friend. And I think lots of people listening to this will think, well, if you've been for dinner twice, maybe in a formal capacity, maybe with other people, that doesn't make you a family friend. Just because you're someone's neighbour, you can barely know your neighbours. Lots of people live in, next door to people they don't speak to for an entire lifetime. And the fact that she once sat on the bench as a magistrate, possibly, maybe at the same time as Lady Britton, maybe not, doesn't make them close family friends. That's not fair,
well,
is it?
As you keep adding to the list, it gets longer and longer to the point where they become family friends. I mean, that's the reality of it. And that's how the vast majority of the public see it. It's only people in the establishment that don't see it like that. And I think the bigger question around this is why the government now seem insistent upon having a tame establishment figure to chair. First we had Baroness Butler Sloss, who was far too close to the situation, and then they were insistent upon choosing Fiona Wolf. It's all very unhealthy. And what's most important is that the chairperson should be the champion for the survivors of child sex abuse.
I think that's clear. That's absolutely clear. But it's not clear whether Fiona Wolf would or would not be one of those. And thank you very much indeed for talking to us. Let's go to Joshua Rosenberg, the legal commentator. Hello, thanks so much for coming in. You can see a great deal of anger there expressed by Simon Danchuk. The idea, he said that they're obviously close
down
family
to
friends. I don't know whether when you get to the particulars of, you know, how many dinners have you had, how well do you know them, are you just a neighbour, are you an associate,
2:09, 2:10 by the time it's
so muddy and so foggy that people just distrusted on
Sunday.
Well, it's getting that way.
Bound.
If you start from the point of view of somebody in the establishment, and the Lord Mayor of London must be a member of the establishment, she is bound to know a lot of people. She has been around. She was president of the Law Society, the leader of the solicitors in England and Wales. She knows a lot of people. And the thing is that people in public life know a lot of other people. People in broadcasting know a lot of other broadcasters. So if you're going to exclude somebody like that, you're going to exclude a lot of very desirable candidates. And lawyers are used to putting their personal views aside. You often have barristers from one set of chambers appearing against
barrister from the same set of chambers, or even sitting in judgment as a part-time judge over people they know very, very well. And lawyers are trained to put their personal views aside and simply judge the facts as they see them.
So let's just go through it. I mean, the idea that she could have gone for dinner at the Britain's house and maybe not be a close friend.